Okay. I want to thank the organizing committee and Dr. Adonianakis for this invitation. I'm very proud to participate in this nice course. These are old statements about the proximal biceps, and some people said that it's somewhat of a maverick, easy to incorporate, but difficult to conduct. And maybe it's an unimportant vestigial structure unless something goes wrong with it. And this is true. What are the reasons for this controversy? Because we have little consensus about the overall function of the tendon, because the diagnosis of the biceps pathology is difficult. Sometimes we have concurrent diseases. The loss of the function is much less detrimental than retaining a diseased tendon. Most authors would agree that the best treatment is to cut it. And of course, there is lack of agreement. It's most evident when discussed about tenotomy or tenodesis. Just a few words about the anatomy. The biceps labral complex has three clinically relevant zones. The first zone is the inside zone, includes the superior labrum and the biceps anchor, the injection, it's the intra-articular portion and the pulley, and the tunnel, that is the extra-articular portion of the long head. We heard about the anatomy of the superior glenoid labrum, that is mobile, and the tension is controlled by the biceps tendon, so it produces a dynamic stability. The margin is about 6.6 millimeters from the glenoid face. We heard also about the attachment of the anchor, and in this study, this is a new study from 2018, based on the classification of Vagnes from 1994. So the type 1, the posterior attachment, is the most common, and there is no significant difference between sex, size, or age. This is the interarticular portion of the tendon. It's about 25 millimeters from the origin to the articular margin, and it has a 6.6 millimeters diameter for tenodesis. And also we have to know that it requires about 20 millimeters of excursion to take the shoulder through a normal range of motion in the scapular plane. Also, the best way to see pathology of the biceps arthroscopically is with a probe, and the best position of the arm is 30 degrees forward flexion, 40 degrees of abduction, and 90 degrees elbow flexion. This is the pulley, and we have contributions from the glenohumeral ligament, the superior glenohumeral ligament, the coracohumeral ligament, the supraspinatus, and the subscapularis to make this construct. It's a little bit complex. And also, you have to know that the biceps pulley has about 10 to 13 millimeters of excursion in the pulley. And finally is the extra-articular portion. Here we have three zones. The zone 1, this is a typical bicipital groove. Type 2 is the no man's land. We can visualize this arthroscopically. And zone 3 is the subpectoralis region. Now, what about the function? We don't know what the long head of the biceps does, because it's a tendon relatively inactive during isolated shoulder motion when the elbow is fixed. Is a humeral head depressor? It's important for anterior, posterior, or inferior stability? We don't know. Has a proprioception? We don't know. Maybe the best study, the latest from 2012, it's from Gebhardt, that showed that there is a minimal effect on in vivo glenohumeral kinematics in subjects with biplane fluoroscopy. These are all the pathologies of the long head of the biceps: inflammatory, rotator cuff disease, primary tendinitis, instability, the pulley lesions, trauma, usually in patients more than 50, a slap lesion, hourglass tendon, which is a specific type. You can see here in the picture, and the groove pathology also. This is a very good article describing the different pathologies that we can find in accordance with the site. So inside, we expect the slap tear and tendinitis or chondromalacia. In the junctional, in the pulley, we see most common partial tears, pulley lesions, chondromalacia. And in the tunnel, we can have partial tears, loose bodies, synovitis, and osteophytes also. These are the tests. We have already discussed about that. And in the same article, these are the best tests to assess the biceps in different locations. So the active compression test of O'Brien is from the inside pathology, the throw-in test for the junction, and the bicipital tenderness for the groove. Now, let's go to the treatment options. So in one hand, we have tenodesis, in the other hand, tenotomy. So tenodesis is a good option for a young, more active patient who need a rigorous elbow forearm activity. It's a stronger fixation. There is no postoperative deformity in most of the cases, but it's a more demanding technically operation, has more complications, and of course is more expensive. The tenotomy is a good option for an old patient, less active. It's easier, it's faster, has a low cost, less complications, but we have the Popeye deformity in about 30% of the patients, and of course, in some patients we have also crabbing pain. So let's see the literature, starting from comparative studies, prospective comparative studies from 2017, 50 patients, all with supraspinatus tear and age more than 40, that was randomly assigned to each group, and you can see that there was no statistical significant difference between the two groups. Let's go to 2018. Again, a prospective randomized clinical trial in isolated biceps pathology lesions, 20 patients only, 9 with tenodesis, 11 with tenotomy, no significant difference in elbow flexion and or forearm supination. Let's go to 2019. Again, a randomized prospective study in 34 patients. About 50 of them had a rotator cuff tear. 2-year follow-up, no statistical significant difference between all the scores. But Popeye deformity was more common in the group of tenotomy, about 25%, and only 1 in 14 patients, 7% in the group of tenodesis. This is another one with rotator cuff tears. So all the patients had rotator cuff repair. Tenotomy in 56 patients. This funnel-shaped tenotomy, it's a little bit more bulky, the proximal stump, so it goes inside the groove and it stops. It's an autotenodesis effect. And tenodesis in the bicipital groove in 72 patients. Both groups show improvements in functional scores, but again, no difference. Of course, Popeye deformity was 3 times higher in the tenotomy group. And the last one is one of the new studies, 2019, no statistical significant difference in outcome. Popeye signed only 1 case in each group, and the tenodesis was performed subpectoral in this study. And now we go into systematic reviews and meta-analysis. This is an old one from 2015. 9 studies, 650 patients. About 62% of the patients had a cuff tear. No significant difference in postoperative costal score, elbow flexion strength, and forearm supination strength. Of course, Popeye deformity and crabbing pain is more common in the tenotomy group. And the other one is new from 2019. It includes the period from 2010 to 2018. Only comparative studies, type 1 and 2, 2 randomized control trials, 5 prospective case series, about 600 patients. And tenotomy resulted in greater rate of Popeye sign, we know that, and it's the only study that says that we have a less fibril constant in this group, but a similar rate of crabbing pain. Some authors suggest to do a tomidesis, this T-shaped tenotomy, in order to for the tendon to go inside the groove and stay there. And some others to cut a little bit of the tendon and then to suture the proximal end with itself just to make the same effect. If you ask the patient about what do they perform, what do they want, a tenodesis or a tenotomy, if you ask them, about 63.7% they want tenodesis, not tenotomy, because they care about the deformity. The rest 30%, they care about the rehabilitation period, so they need something fast. Okay, 63% they prefer tenodesis. So if you are to perform a tenotomy, you have to inform your patients about this complication, the Popeye sign. Probably larger studies, prospective randomized studies like this one from Netherlands, more than 100 patients, they call it the BITE study, tenotomy versus tenodesis. Maybe we have an answer in the future from that. And in conclusion, we can say that tenotomy is a reasonable option for the older, less active patient with a symptomatic biceps pathology who can accept the deformity, or he needs a faster rehabilitation period. Tenodesis is a more reasonable option for the young, athletic, active patient who has concerns about cosmesis. But the functional result is the same. You can see all these papers. Thank you very much.